The Rogue. It's a fan favorite. It might even be why you clicked on this video. The fantasy of playing that slippery, stealthy, sometimes snarky anti-hero is quite a popular one. I think playing a rogue actually leans into the underdog story, but dissecting why people play rogues isn't exactly why we're here today. No, tis the season of reevaluation. Whether you're calling this 1D&D 5.5, a rules update, people are re-examining how we play Dungeons & Dragons. And that got me thinking about the rogue, and there's just this one thing that just bothers me. To be frank, I think the 5e rogue fails to meet the expectations that it sets when you're deciding what class you want to play. Now, many of you just heard me say that the rogue sucks. I didn't say that. What I said was, I think the 5e rogue fails to meet the expectations that it sets. To illustrate my point, we must travel back in time. I remember back in 2014 when I first picked up the Player's Handbook. I saw the rogue table, I looked at the sneak attack column, and my imagination exploded with all of the damage that I could deal. Then I glanced over at the barbarian and the fighter, and then I actually laughed when I saw that all they get is an extra attack. I was like, so at best, they deal 2d12 damage while I continually get stronger as I level? I will be the most powerful character in the game! Then, when I was deciding what subclass to play, I looked at the assassin and saw, I have a path to auto crits too? Wow! I'm gonna deal even more damage! But then I actually played a rogue, and I soon realized that that classic, moody, lone wolf character that I envisioned playing was often unable to do the things that the class itself is designed to do unless I had help. And sure, I could use my bonus action to hide once I get my cunning action and try and get myself advantage on these attack rolls, but there's only so many times you can hide behind the same tree or rock or wall or whatever it is you're using before your dungeon master is just like, this doesn't make sense anymore. They know you're there. Now, as you're watching this video, you might be sitting there thinking like, well, I get what you're saying, but if that's what you're thinking you're gonna do as a rogue, you're not really playing them right. And perhaps that's a fair argument. All I'm looking for here really is just a somewhat reliable path to dealing sneak attack damage on my own. Now, I do understand that using the hide action as a bonus action will get the job done, but the thing is there isn't always something to hide behind. I also realize that the aim feature they gave us in Tasha's Cauldron of Everything will get the job done, but it burns both my movement and my bonus action to do it. That's a really heavy price to pay. And I also kind of just think it's weird that I might have to have this expectation or just have to rely on my allies, or really my friends, to alter what they might want to do just so that I can do what I'm designed to do. Something about that just seems off to me. If you're a battlemaster fighter and you want to push a target away because that's the cool thing you want to do for your turn, go for it. I should be able to also still do the thing I want to do. It might not work every time, but I should have a path there. What if cunning action had like some other like fighting dirty feature where you use your bonus action and perhaps the target had to do some kind of saving throw, whether you're like throwing dust in someone's eye, taunting them, whatever odd imagination thing you could come up with. If there's a saving throw that doesn't even have to give you advantage, just let me deal my sneak attack damage if I hit him. That's all I need. Now, of course, I realize that there's more to the rogue than just sneak attack, and if you go back to the history of it, really, the backstab is what it was originally called. It didn't come into play very often, but the draw of the rogue or the thief back in those days was all the skills they could do, the disarming of traps, all these kinds of things, and that is still very present. And like I said at the top of the video, I'm not saying the rogue sucks. I'm just critiquing this one thing that just feels off to me. So if you're here watching this video or wanting to play a rogue and the combat fantasy is the draw, I would like to at least point you in the direction of the Battlemaster Fighter. Take 5 levels there, take maneuvers like trip attack so that you have a path to dealing your sneak attack on your terms, and you'll also just be a little bit more reliable if that doesn't work out. And then you go rogue the rest of the way and that sneak attack is still gonna get really nasty. And even if the skill part of the rogue is the draw for you, I mean, there's a big case to be made for just saying, hey, just go bard. You still get expertise. You'll get a whole suite of spells to be able to do all sorts of nasty shenanigans. And, I mean, in my opinion, I'd actually be better at it. And don't get me wrong, the rogue is great at skills. They're great at things like stealth and finding and disarming traps. It just seems like the only trap they can't disarm is the trap of playing the rogue. I couldn't resist that one, kind of a little sneak attack of my own for you. But since we're under the hood with this one D&D rules update, we're reevaluating all of it. I think this needs some attention. This could be reevaluated, but I also want to know what you think about this. Am I crazy? Because after I played a rogue that one time, I just didn't want to do it again. I just didn't. So thank you so much for watching. Please let me know that you got to the end of the video by giving me three emojis that are your favorite way to represent the rogue. And I hope you have a wonderful day. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.